All right. Hello, everyone, and welcome to 1500 Feelings, where we are going to be talking about, you guessed it, 1500 Miles from the Sun by Johnny Garzavilla. My name is Adri. I'm a queer, trans, non-binary Mexican-American book reviewer and writer. You're currently on my YouTube channel, where I have been loudly talking about books since 2013. And I'm honored to be joined by, of course, Johnny Garzavilla himself, and also, no big deal, two-time New York Times bestselling author, Aiden Thomas. Not going to say I said anything or I called it first, but I kind of called it first. So. But thank you both so much for being here. I think we're going to have a great time. And I'm also contractually obligated to say that Amparo Ortiz is the person who named this panel slash discussion. I'm supposed to like reference her genius or something here. So
it's true.
There is a person off screen holding a gun to my head, actually, if you say that. So, but thank you, Amparo. We adore you. We appreciate you. But yeah, so just to start us off easy, on the slim chance that people don't know who you are, I want to give you both a chance to introduce yourself and your books in your own words. So Aiden, we're going to start with you. Who are you? What do you do? What do you write?
My name is Aiden Thomas. I have written Cemetery Boys and Lost in the Neverwoods. Cemetery Boys is a, I call it a Latinx ghost story turned like gay rom-com. And it's about a trans boy who can summon ghosts, and he accidentally summons the wrong one, and his name is Julian Diaz. And it's about them trying to solve a murder mystery and also figuring out what happened to Julian, and then also falling madly, deeply, gaily in love with each other. And then Lost in the Neverwoods is a very dark contemporary reimagining of the Peter Pan canon that's set in a small town and has to do with missing kids, creepy woods, and a malicious shadow.
Hey, we love it. We love both. And now, Johnny, tell us about yourself and then let the good people know what 1500 Miles from the Sun is all about.
Yeah, I'm Johnny Garzavilla. I wrote this book, 1500 Miles from the Sun. It's Jesus Christ.
Right, bright as the sun.
That's cute. But yeah, it is about Corpus Christi, Texas high school senior Julian Luna, aka Jules, who accidentally comes out as gay on Twitter after getting just tremendously drunk at a party. And like in the days and weeks and months afterwards, he gets to discover all of like the joy and love and happiness that can be a part of the process of coming out, especially whenever like your long distance crush from LA slides into your DMs, and but also like the bad stuff and the trauma and rejection that can also be very much a part of that process. And yeah, that comes out like in a few weeks.
It's fun. We swear. It's fun. It's cute. But it's also full of feelings. So
I'm really excited to read the finished copy, because I feel like I've read the arc so many times I'm going to be able to like tell like what the differences are. I'd be like, oh, there's a different word there.
That's going to be me. So to everyone watching, we are open to audience questions. So if you have any questions for any of us that or that you want us to discuss within reason, feel free to drop them in the chat and then we'll try to get to them as they come up. Can't promise that because I got a lot of stuff going on, but we'll see. So I kind of want to start very generally. So Johnny, let's give you the typical question. Where did you get the inspiration for 1500 Miles from the Sun? Like, where did it start? Where did it come from? Take us on the journey.
Yeah, so it started because I read Simon versus the Homo Sapiens Agenda. And then like, I read it because the movie was coming out. So I was like, oh, I should read the book. And then I'll go to the movie. And so I did both. And then like after the movie, I went with like a bunch of like other queer Latina friends. And we were talking about just like how like the Mexican American gay experience doesn't really get the sort of like media presence that like typical white coming out stories do. And probably because I was pretty drunk whenever we were talking about it, like I was just like, you know what? I'm going to do it. I'm going to write something gay and speak on it. And so like I drafted the first draft like in NaNoWriMo 2018. Mm-hmm. And it was like the first book length thing I've ever written in my second attempt. And then, yeah, just kind of went from there. I got my agent like the next year, and then went on sub, and now it's here. Changed the title, and now we're here.
What was the original title?
It was Sunshine and Moonlight.
Oh, I love that.
Sunshine and Moonlight.
Yeah.
They're like, that's a little too spot on. Let's make it poetic. It was,
like, too matte forward. Like, they wanted it to be more like Jules forward. And so I came up with this, and that worked.
I love that. Yeah, it's super good. I feel like we should just say that off the bat. It's incredible. And I feel like the first thing I did when I finished reading it was, I'm pretty sure I messaged you, Johnny. I cannot remember what I said. Probably like, how dare you? Or something like, or like, you can't do this. Something like that. Like, you can't do this. Whatever. Something like that. But it was, or like, how dare you write the perfect book? Or something like, I can't remember. But it was angry and it was emotional because it was that good. But kind of related to that, Aiden, you are one of Johnny's earliest readers that I can remember. So do you remember what you felt as you read the story, and like, why do you think readers should be excited for 1500 Miles from the Sun?
Oh my gosh. Yeah. When I can't remember if Johnny, if you DM'd me or if you emailed me, but when I got the message, I was like, oh yes, because I'd been like hearing about it from you on Twitter. And I was like, I deeply need to read this, send me an arc immediately. And I think it's so hard to find books with representation that I actually feel like I connect to, right? Especially when it comes to Latinx identity. And so to like have this book that was like centered around that was so exciting. And to have like the love interest being California, because I'm from California, that was like another like added. And so it was just like, it's was full of these like very quiet, sweet moments that were just so intensely relatable that hadn't happened to me reading any kind of book. And so while I was reading 1500 Miles from the Sun, it was really, I was like, oh, this is important. This is something that I haven't experienced before. And I was so excited. And I kept like messaging my friends. I was like, I'm reading this arc and it's so good. I was like, I can't tell you guys like how special this is. And then while I was reading it, I had also been working on writing a rom-com. And I was having a lot of trouble with it. And while I was reading Johnny's book, I was like, okay, they know exactly what they're doing. And the, just like the craft of this, like aside from like all the mushy-gushy feelings I have about it, the craft of it is so, so well done. It actually taught me a lot about how to write my rom-com while I was reading it. So I owe you acknowledgments whenever that rom-com does get published. But yeah, I can't explain. And I think that, you know, like white cishet readers are so used to kind of seeing themselves and being able to so easily relate to characters and stories that it's really hard to explain how important and meaningful 1500 Miles from the Sun was for me, and still is and will continue to be. So yeah, it was just, it blew my mind and I was just so excited. And I'm still so excited.
I'm still so excited. I get so hyped about 1500 Miles from the Sun. That was definitely me. I was like, as soon as I finished it, I went to the group chat and I was like, pre-order 1500 Miles from the Sun right now. Like, trust me on this one, guys. Like, you need it. And like, exactly. I'll say that again right here. You need it. Pre-order links are in the description, by the way, in case anyone's interested. There's a question here from Moonbook. Says, what do you think about your book cover? I assume this is for Johnny, but Aiden, you can hop in if you want afterwards.
Oh, I love it. Like, I mean, like, you, Jesus, again, you have like two like brown boys on a book cover. Like, I feel like probably, I can't think of another like strictly contemporary young adult book that has a Mexican American teen like right there on the cover.
On the cover, yeah.
Like, the, you know, like this is like it. I love it, and I'm. Yeah, and my incredible agent sibling, Jade Bat, was the cover artist for it, and she did an amazing job, I think. Like, got his whole ass soccer ball there, and the fucking hands, like, god damn it, the fucking hands.
I love that.
Yeah, I love it.
It's so dramatic. I love it. I think you're right, too. I don't think I've seen a queer YA book that has, like, a Mexican-American protagonist on the cover. The only other one I think of is, like, Aristotle and Dante, and that's, like, the truck. That's only the person.
Yeah.
So, Are you making history? That's my question. Like, are we making history? No,
we're constantly, yeah.
Unless it's, no, there's probably some other book. I don't want to like say the wrong thing. So I don't know. There's my, that's my thing. Here's an attack for Aiden. Are you going to write the gay Mexican cowboy book? I have this same question.
I really want to. I'm thinking about possibly co-writing it with someone who is maybe intimately connected to this current situation. So we'll see. I'm trying to plan it out. We are trying to plan it out, though.
So. Yeah, but you both have like a million other books to write first. It won't be till like 2025. Gay Mexican cowboys coming your way. But anyways, so since you're both YA authors, obviously you both had to approach writing high school experiences in your stories. And Johnny's especially feels such a good about such does such a good job of capturing that like nostalgic feel of like being with your friends and living out that like senior year in high school. So I'm curious to know how you both tapped into that voice and those experiences. And Johnny, we'll start with you.
Yeah, I think rather than saying I wanted it to be like a homecoming book or like a prom book or like a spring break book, like I wanted it to be a book just kind of where friends got together and just did a little in the he's small, like instead of just focusing on events for the plot to revolve around. Like I really wanted to put an effort to just make them feel like real teenagers because I felt like that was what was more important. And just to build like all of these feelings and sensory experiences that happen in the book to like bring in you like into their group. Not that like, those things don't happen, like there is homecoming and prom and like actual glimpses of it, but not really like plot wise. I guess like soccer is the only exception to that rule. But like, at best, like I just kind of wanted it to feel like you were their friend and like you were hanging out with them. And like, that was kind of the goal of it. That, you know, you were just kind of like sitting at lunch or hanging out with like Jules and Isel and Jordan and Rolly and Lou and Pina and like all of them.
Yes. I think you nailed that though. Cause I did feel like I was hanging out with your characters. It felt like a vibe, especially cause like they do relatable like teenager shit, you know, like they actually like go to the drive-thru after school just to get like a $2 drink and then like go to the beach, like things that don't cost money. I think that was like the big thing that kind of connected it for me. Cause like when I was in high school, I wasn't like doing all these fancy things and going on all these big trips. I couldn't even go on like the field trips that like people would go to. Like here in California in eighth grade, you go to like, there's an East Coast trip. That's a big thing here in Southern California. And I couldn't go cause like my family couldn't afford to do that. So it's like, me and my friends are always doing these like sort of shortcut, like, hey, like what can we do for free? But like, that's still like us hanging out and like vibing together. So like, I feel like you really captured that. It was just like, can't explain it. I can't explain
it. I like lived at Sonic after school during high school.
Love that. McDonald's. We didn't have Sonic here, but it was McDonald's. What about you, Aiden?
Gosh, for me, kind of like that, writing in that high school experiences. When I was in high school, speaking of free things, just trying to like do stuff because there was nowhere to go, I hung out in a cemetery a lot with my friends in high school. And which is like related, obviously, to cemetery boys. I was born and raised in Oakland, California. I just moved away from there like four years ago. And there is a cemetery, it's called Mountain View Cemetery in Oakland. And it's like right in the middle of the city and it's up on this huge hill. So you kind of have a view of like the whole Bay Area and like San Francisco and the distance. And it's funny cause it's like, the community in general didn't really treat it as a cemetery. Like it was more of a park. Like moms would take their kids in strollers on walks, people would go running through it, and teenagers like me and my friends would go and just like hang out, and it wasn't really seen as like this creepy like dark place. It's just like, oh yeah, we're just gonna go hang out at Mountain View, which I think taps into kind of my personal cultural experience being Latinx and like the view of death and how I don't really see it as a dark, scary or like depressing thing. It's more of like, you know, a celebration. It's not the end. So I think that that kind of aligned with it really nicely. But when it comes to like that authenticity of like the high school experience, I think for me, my favorite part was just writing Julian, the love interest, because his level of like chaoticness is like that quintessential like TikTok kids that are just like off the wall doing all this like hilarious but like zero attention span stuff. And I really wanted to have characters that talked and acted like teenagers. So I think that was probably my favorite part. I think oftentimes in young adult literature, especially fantasy, but also rom-coms, there's like this idea that the love interest has to be like kind of dark and brooding with like this tragic past or whatever. And then like, and then me and Johnny, we have Matt and Julian, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Like the most it's chaotic so and most you could ever like shove into a room together. And I think that that's
you imagine like, and,
oh my God.
Oh my God.
It would be amazing.
Don't even go there. Okay, that's too much. But yeah, Aiden, what I loved about yours was I just felt like Gabrielle was just so realistic and like as a high schooler. One of my favorite like little details in the book is like the fact that he's so hung up about his math test. Like that is my favorite fucking detail in the entire book. It's like your boy just became a brujo. Like he just came on this like soul, this spirit that he's attached to that he has to like help figure out what's going on and like send him back to the afterlife. And he's like, that's great. Would love to help you. I got a math test tomorrow that like I am not going to miss. Like that was me in high school.
Poor Yaz. He never gets a break.
He does take the test though, for anyone who's concerned, he does take the test. So that was like the most realistic high school thing, especially because I used to work in high school. So I feel like that was something I saw a lot, was like kids who are like, I've studied for this test. Don't speak to me. I'm going to sit down and I'm going to take it. And then I'll be free. So that is like the high school experience.
It was like that. And then like using the boys' bathroom for the first time, I feel like the other deeply relatable high school experience for trans. Yeah.
Especially because he's like, it's gross in here, but like I have to do it. I have to do it.
Yeah.
I guess so. Bada has a question. What is a book or TV show that's giving you all the feelings right now? I don't want to go first. Johnny, do you have anything giving you the feelings?
I was watching the second part of the Selena series this week, and I haven't watched the last two episodes because I know what happens, and I can't watch that. Like,
exactly.
At the end of the movie, I'm not going to watch the end of it either. And no one can force me to do that. So instead, I just went and listened to Selena on Spotify.
Good solution. What about you, Aiden?
I've been rewatching one of my favorite TV shows on Netflix because I just found out that it's like getting canceled, which is On My Block, which was a huge inspo for Cemetery Boys in terms of like tone. So I've been like rewatching that series and like getting emotional at the same beats that I get emotional at every time. And just kind of being sad that it's going to end after four seasons.
That is sad.
Literally, like Ruby was the first foundational like comp to like Jules.
Like,
I see that
totally
actually.
That.
Like, basically, like Jasmine is Lou. Like, I copy pasted it. Like,
Jasmine. You're right. Now that you say it, I see it. I don't know if I'm supposed to answer. I haven't been watching anything. I've been recovering from top surgery, so I must have been rewatching stuff. So I've been rewatching like Oran High School Host Club, which is like ultimate gay weeb like lifestyle. So that's what I've been doing.
Player movie recently, and that one was pretty emotional.
Like, don't humble brag. I'm not going to a movie theater right now, Johnny. Okay? I have to wait for it to come to Crunchyroll like the rest of the world, okay? So something else that's prominent in kind of both of your books is food. It's very much like its own kind of character in both of these stories that we're talking about. So what are some foodie Easter eggs that readers can expect to find in your book or books? And why did you choose to include them? Johnny, you can go first.
I like had to dig into like Easter egg food stuff because most of it's just like Jules cooks or like it's does. Like very obvious that they're like at Whataburger for the 50th time.
Well, yeah, yeah. I feel like you need to do a partnership with Whataburger because like when you name drop them so much.
So open to sponsorship. But there like are a couple of places that weren't mentioned that like are actual places and they were both in LA. The first one, like I just remember I went, both of them I went on the second time I was there. And one of them was like, just like, I loved the food there. And I was like, okay, like I need to mention this one. And I had actually mentioned it in my book. It's called like Kitchen 24, but like the K is like lowercase and it's all like one word. And all my editors kept on getting mad at me for that. And I'm like, this is what it's called. Like,
the name of the place. It's
spelled. And so I just took it out because everyone kept bothering me about it.
Oh my
so
God.
That's not mentioned anymore. And then there, the ramen shop that like is mentioned in there,
oh,
like
yes.
actual ramen shop in Little Tokyo, like right down the street from like the one of the contemporary art museums and like a Japanese American museum.
Ooh, yeah, you're definitely gonna want burgers and ramen and all that after you read this book. So, what about you, Aiden?
For me, like doing the Easter eggs that were like very specifically like East LA Boyle Heights, like this like really janky Jack in the Box that like everyone kind of knows about, like dropped that one in. And then there's King Taco, which is King like, which Taco. Is a real place.
It's a real place.
It's very important and it's open 24 hours. And yeah, that place is so bomb. I was like, okay, it's I have funny. To have it. Like in Cemetery Boys, and of course Julian is like madly in love with it, and that's where we get the taco moment that a lot of people love. But I think the most like the one where I was just like, oh yes, this is me, yes. and like I bring it up in every book is Conchas because I'm obsessed with them.
Yes,
and they're just gonna kind of be in everything I write. Apparently, it's fine. Okay. And just like that very. Just like whenever I think of them, it's like the smell, it's the taste, but it's also like the cases with the plastic like drawers that you open up with like the little pink bags, and then like or out of the back of like the panman's like pan truck where it's like toolboxes, but there's like pan in them with like the big drawers. I don't know if you guys had
those
where you were growing up. Yeah. So it's like, yeah, pan is a very important one to me.
I love that. Amparo says, Whataburger sans rice. We could like have it out. You guys want to have it out? Like, because like Aiden and I from California are like affiliated with In-N-Out.
Yes.
Johnny, you're affiliated with Whataburger. Like, do we want to say like who's supreme? I don't have a horse in this race, so.
I mean, it's In-N-Out, but I also haven't tried Whataburger, so.
That's true. We don't have them here, so.
And, like, I will say that In-N-Out in California, like, is good. It is. The one.
Johnny's like, I don't want to lose book sales. Like, In-N-Out is fine.
The ones here are trash. So, yeah.
Oh, so you do have
really went out that far.
What? Yeah, we have, like, two, I think, in San Antonio.
Oh, wow. I had no idea.
Yeah.
Wild.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Jeez.
You gotta get them in California.
You do. Like, if you're going to eat it, just go to California.
Yeah. I was literally, like, my home where I grew up was, like, down the street, close to an In-N-Out. And I also worked actually down the street from an In-N-Out. So it's just, like, it's part of the culture.
Part of the culture. Jeez. Sorry, now I'm just thinking. I don't eat beef, so that's why I don't have a horse in this race. So I am exempt from answering. Because I don't need anything in and out. Anyways, so Johnny, 1500 Miles from the Sun is a story that predominantly showcases long distance and online relationships, which is really exciting. Very excited for people to read that. So why was that a dynamic that you wanted to tackle? And what were some of the obstacles that came with it?
Mainly I decided that because conceptualizing this book, I knew that I wanted to write a story that was like in some way in LA or dealing with LA because like I really love that city and I was like, I want to like write about it, but I also like don't know enough about it to like write a whole book in LA, and like writing about Texas is much more familiar to me. And so I was like, well, I can maybe do both. I can do both. And so that kind of like where that stemmed from, like, let me just have a long distance relationship. And like, one's in LA and one's in Texas. And I can do what I want. And so like, that's kind of why I decided it. I love the idea of like just social media and like, especially in queer culture and young queer culture and like how that resonates. And like, I'm sure like everyone like who's had like social media in their lives has had a social media crush at one point or another. Like, it's all just kind of the thing. And And so I just really wanted to explore that. And I like also really love the potential to just build yearning in a long distance relationship, because there's not a lot of things that like you can do when you can just go and like drive over to your crush's house. Like, if you can't do that, you're just going to be like wanting this for forever, which is kind of the whole book. And like, just so much to where even I was like, oh my God, how much longer before they can meet? Like, they better get to meet or else I will hurt myself. Like, I will beat myself up. Like, and they better get to meet soon. Like,
for me.
And I think it also helped because I wanted to make it equal parts romance and also like a coming of age for Jules and like building on his coming out experience. And so being able to have him like in his own little experiences without Matt allowed me to kind of put focus on him whenever I wanted to put focus on him, which is a little difficult because then I had like Matt, who I was like, I have to remember that there's some things that he's not gonna know because he's not there. And sometimes I find myself like writing parts and I'm like, wait, like he doesn't know what he's saying, right? Like, he wouldn't know what he's saying right now. Like, oh, that was a little childsome, but
yeah. What I liked so much about reading this, especially during a pandemic, was like, as I was reading it, I was like, there's so many teens that are experiencing this possibly for the first time and like doing the long distance thing and how you only have like your phone or your laptop to communicate and like connect with. And so for me, that was an added like, oh, this is really cool. I was reading it.
Exactly. I think it's one of the first times I've read about an online, like sustained, like long distance relationship in a,
yeah,
YA book, especially a queer YA book. So like, that was very beautiful. I love that. And yeah, I think Johnny kind of nailed it on the head that like, the internet is a big point of connection, especially for queer youth and especially for queer youth who are intersectional with another experience, like being queer Latinx, like we all are. So yeah, that's true. That's how we find our people is on the internet.
So true.
Not in our lives.
So that like, any Ariana Grande stan account can find the love of their life on Twitter if they just try enough. Like,
that's true. give people something to hope about.
Yeah.
Something to strive for. So this is your sign from the universe to like drop in on your crush's DMs today.
Yes.
This is fine. Do
Go
it.
Go for it.
I know Ambato somewhere is yelling like, yes, do it. No, we're not talking about Facebook. Facebook is cursed. Facebook is not it's not part of this conversation. You see your way out. So this is something I wanted to ask the most. So Selena's music makes appearances in both of your books. I wanna know why it was important for you to reference her music and her legacy in your work, and how has her music influenced the way that you experience or explore culture for yourself?
I mean, like, everything that I've written so far has included Selena in some way. So that's just going to be the thing that happens.
But also,
Selena is Tejana culture. Like, I mean, just if we're going to be blunt about it, like, besides food, too, I think Selena has probably been what's connected me most to my culture growing up, like, not speaking Spanish really and growing up in like a white ass small town. Like, food and Selena were really the things I was like, okay, like, this connects me to being Mexican.
Yes.
And like, just I didn't think I could write a story that was set in Corpus Christi that was about a gay Mexican kid and not mention her in some way. Like, of course he's gonna know who she is. And I just think that like her songs are so fitting for specific moments. Like, when I think of Jules and Matt in really any kind of context, I think of like Dreaming of You or a baby.
Dreaming of You. Johnny ruined that song for me. I can't, like, I get so mad when it comes on now.
That was my goal. This is my goal.
I hate it. I've said it before. If like Dreaming of You was a book, it would be 1500 Miles from the Sun. Like literally top to bottom, front to back. It is that song. I'm glad you brought up the sacrilege though, because it would have been Mexican sacrilege for you to set your book in Corpus Christi and not.
Right. So when I was doing edits, one of my editors was like, literally asked if Jules would know who Selena is. And I had to like calm down and walk away from my computer for a little bit before telling him that, yeah, like a gay ass Corpus Christi would know, who's gone to at least one quinceañera probably would know who Selena is. Like,
Why are we even asking? I feel you. I would be offended.
Yeah, I mean, like growing up, it was like Selena is like the like again, same kind of thing about connection to like culture. I luckily grew up in Oakland, California, so it was incredibly diverse. But you know, my parents and my grandparents didn't teach me Spanish, so my connection to that was like Selena. And me and my sister were so madly in love with her. And I remember specifically like where we found out that she had passed, was like not alive anymore. And how like torn down we were. And then I think a couple of years later we watched the Selena movie and like how that just like scarred both of us for like life. And it's like, I don't know how to, people ask me about Selena all the time. And they're like, well, like, what's the deal? And I don't even know how to, like, properly convey how important she was for Latinos, especially for Mexican-American folks. And, yeah, I just get, like, caught up, and it makes my heart hurt. And even just, like, talking about the song, like, my eyes started watering. It's, like, it's very emotional.
It's true.
It's, like, it's very emotional, even outside of, like, us being Latinx and being, like, emotional people in general. Like, it's on this whole other level.
It is.
And yeah, just her music and like listening to it when I was like a little kid in my bedroom, like, you know, trying to fall asleep with like, you know, like my Walkman with the really bad like headphones and stuff. It's like, it's a whole thing. It's a whole experience. It's a whole, I feel like Selena and her music is a whole like love language in and of itself.
It is.
And so to me, it's important to talk about her and to, yeah, make sure that nobody ever forgets about her, you know?
That's true. Even though they couldn't. Legend, they couldn't.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I feel you. I feel like haunted by her. I don't know how to like explain it, but I feel like because she died.
Way.
Yeah, but because she died tragically and so young, I feel like haunted by her in ways I can't even explain. Like sometimes I'll just be like, she'll come on shuffle and I'm like at a stoplight. I'm like, what would life be like if Selena was still alive? Like, it's just, sorry.
No, like passing by like the Astrodome in Houston, we just
stop. Why did you choose Como la Flor, Aiden, for Cemetery Boys? Was it just because it's a bopper?
Because that's what my my abuela likes to sing in the kitchen when she's trying to make me dance with her. It's that song.
So
that was
life.
Like a very like real life experience and a process that I get dragged through on the regular. So that's why that one. And it's such it's such a bop, but also
bop.
It's what my abuelita likes to croon to, as I call it.
Oh my god! Yeah, no, I totally agree with both of you. I feel like Selena was definitely my first and strongest like connection to the Spanish language specifically and like Spanish language music. So she was like a big entry point for that for me. Besides like my, this is so weird, but like my dad was a professional ballet folklorico dancer. So like the only other like Mexican music I knew was like mariachi and like traditional like regional like Mexican music. So like Selena was like the first like modern, like, okay, like I vibe with this. I don't know what she's saying, but like, I love it so much that I'm gonna like learn. And I feel like that process of like learning her lyrics like made me feel like connected to like my Mexican heritage in a way I can't explain. Cause I also was not taught Spanish growing up, but so it's real, y'all. The Selena feels are real.
That's the thing, right? Like just speaking about like language and like immigration, like I'm second generation American. My grandparents are all immigrants. And the like when they came to America, they're pushed upon this idea that, like, in order to be American, in order for you to fit in and belong here, you need to speak our language, which is still a discourse that's being pushed constantly. And so, like, our families tried to did set us up for success. They tried to make sure that we, you know, assimilated for safety, for whatever success or whatever reasons. But because of that, we like lose that part of our culture. And I think for a lot of people, rediscovering that culture and finding connection to it is through music, and especially Selena.
Yes.
Yeah.
She's a real one. This is related. It says, is there a 1500 Miles from the Sun full playlist I should listen to while reading?
Oh, there are two.
Two.
There's like, I have
the real
like
one and the fake one.
Well, I have like the one that's like my like indie coming of age Netflix playlist version. And I also like there is a playlist mentioned in the book, like kind of like way far down.
There is.
And I like made that playlist, and like they're two very different vibes, but like
so
I
have those.
Have you posted them? Like yeah, why yeah, haven't like, I seen them
I,
personally?
I don't. I feel like I have before. At least
do it again.
Yeah, do it again.
Well. Do it again.
Immediately after this.
Oh, yeah. I did, actually, there's three. I have a Costina party playlist that, like, Joel's.
Hey, drop them all. This person says, both of your books include a lot of yearning. Yes. What are your favorite books, movies, or TV shows that also have a lot of yearning?
Ooh. Oh, gosh.
Who wants to go first? Johnny?
Hold on. I need a...
Love that. Casually move aside to show the
print. Oh, that's really good lighting, too, in my head.
Yes.
It's so hard. Like right now, Felix Ever After kind of comes to mind.
Oh, yes. God. Yes.
This is, not like new media, but it takes a lot for me to get emotional about stuff. Selena aside, she doesn't count. but the movie Your Name gets me every freaking time I watch it. I get... Like, I do not cry. I haven't cried in years. It's just not something I do. But every time I watch that flipping movie, I will get, like, misty-eyed at certain points, whether it's, like, the visuals or the dialogue, which is killer, or the music. And it, oh, my God, it gets me. And the yearning, it, like, my heart, oh, my God, it's so good. It's, like, the best
next
movie ever.
Level yearning for anyone who doesn't know. They're, like, in two completely different places, two characters who don't know each other. So ultimate yearning.
It's so good.
Oh, my God. Let's see. I don't want to butcher this with my my Spanish that's imperfect. But rough translation, I think it's saying, what's your opinion of using Spanish in your books? Who wants to go first?
I use it. I am like very pro using it. And like, I feel like my type of using Spanish in books often doesn't come with like a direct translation afterwards, or even like sometimes not even, I mean, there is context, I think, but like, maybe like if you're completely new to it, maybe not you might need Google Translate. I don't know. And if that's a thing for you and it's uncomfortable, I'm sorry. but like, I love Spanish. Even though like I'm not super confident in speaking it, like I know, like I can hear it and know it better than like speaking it. And like what I do know is really made from like living in San Antonio and like going to a heavily Latinx college and working at a retail shop near an airport. Like, that's basically, I have retail Spanish. And so, like...
God, that's so relatable.
But, like, I loved using it. I loved writing Spanish in there and, like, getting to talk to my friends whenever I didn't know words or phrases and be like, how would you say this? Like, let's discuss. And, like, get them telling me how to do it, or, like, even, like, them saying, this is how one might do it. But if you're, like, a grandmother saying it, they'd probably say it this way. If you're my cousin in Laredo saying it, say it this way. Like, learning all of that, and like I think even my second book, like according to my agent, my second book just kind of floors it on the Spanish too, and so like it's just something I really love doing.
Yes, something to look forward to.
Yeah, for me it's similar using Spanish, but I when I was writing Cemetery Boys, I really had like a purpose and direction and thoughtfulness when it came to how I used Spanish, when I used it, and who was using it.
No, sorry. There's some lines that are attacked. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, like specifically Julian and how and when he uses Spanish is very like relevant to plot and kind of his arc. But I think what's really fun is like not translating stuff and sometimes not having context. And it's fun because first you have people who know Spanish, and so they read these lines that Audrey's referring to, and they're like, oh, this is a special thing that's just for me. And it is. It's a special thing that's just for you, for, you know, Spanish speakers. But then I think that there's also another really exciting component for those moments when I use Spanish for people who don't speak it, because it's like, here's this bit of line. You're seeing all the action around it and the responses, and you're like, oh my God, what does it mean? What does it mean? So people grab their phone and then they translate it, and you're like building up all this anxiety, and then you put it in, and then it like translates it for you, and then everyone's like, oh my God. Like, the build up and like the payoff, I think, is great. So like, I like leaning into that.
I love that. I had a friend who did that when they read Cemetery Boys. They were like using Google Translate. They're like, what does it mean? And then like they couldn't be like, what does it mean? I'm like, look it up.
And then so they cry. It's great.
It is. You also made me like hate words like Sobrino. I was like,
Yeah.
Anyway, so we'll not go into that. But anyway. Yeah, no, I agree with both of you. Like, even with this question, like, I could have read it in Spanish, but like, my brain was like, don't do that. Like, don't embarrass yourself. Like, I'm just gonna absolutely not. So yes, I definitely relate that I can listen to and read Spanish almost fluently. In the moment, though, it just doesn't come to me because I was taught to think in English. So the English comes first. And which is unfortunate because English
and
is
even, like, I mean, whenever I was conceiving like this friend group, in my head, like, these people talk Spanish to each other. Like, maybe aside from Jordan, but like, if they're like, if it's like Jules and Itzel and Rolly together, like, they're not speaking English. Like, that even if I write it in English, in my head while I'm imagining them speak it, like, they're speaking in Spanish. Like, these kids are speaking Spanish. And so I wanted to really like honor that and like the kind of aesthetic and vibe that I was painting for them, and like I didn't want to just like anglicize that just for
stay confused. That's my stance. Stay confused. Don't look it up, look it up, deal with it. That's my stance.
I had to Google Translate a lot of it, so like, you know, if I can do it, like, anyway,
that's true. That's me when I'm writing. I'm like, Mom, how did you say this sentence in Spanish? And she's like, what are you doing? It's like something completely random, and I'm just like,
I would look it up and be like, I feel pretty confident in this translation, so I'm gonna go with it. And
then like, yeah, I would so for
like, no, it's wonky. Let me go ask someone else. I know this is wonky.
For the really important lines, pretty much all the ones that Julian used, I would text one of my dear friends, Francisco, for him to kind of walk me through it and for us to like go back and forth and like get like the tone and the vibe down right. And it was so funny because like I would be writing in the middle of the night, so I'd be like sending my friend Francisco like text messages being like, you up at like 2 o'clock in the morning? He's like awake to help me like work through the right word I want to use. It's very funny.
I love that because it's like such a different connotation of like the you up text.
Yeah, what are you doing?
Are you up? I need some Spanish help.
Yeah.
So kind of related to that, both of your stories sit at the intersection of Latinidad and queerness, as we've kind of been talking about. So are there aspects of that experience that you feel are still missing in the industry and that you were hoping to address in your books? Johnny, you can go first again.
I feel like, especially as someone who writes specifically contemporary Chicana stories, I just think we're lacking that. Like, I think we're lacking contemporary stories. Like, and I've said this before in like other cases, but the go-to novel for the queer Mexican-American experience is a book that takes place in the 80s, like before any young reader was even born, before I was even born.
Yeah,
like, that's the go-to book for the queer Mexican experience. Like, we need some that involve cell phones and involve social media and involve things that kids are going through today. Like,
yeah,
I think that's important. And so I wanted to write something that felt current and felt specifically for like the Mexican-American living in South Texas, because also like we just don't see a lot of Texas stories that take place south of Austin or Houston. And I think that that needs to be something that like is more predominantly seen in fiction. And I wanted to write something that's like sort of cliche, like we've all seen a lot of coming out stories like in all forms of media, but something like 300 Miles from the Sun, I think is just so far removed from the whiteness that defines so much of like the most well-known queer stories. And I really wanted to push that. I wanted to make it known that like we can write our own experience without needing the white friend or the white love interest. And I just really wanted to push like a very diverse book and like a very brown book and just like yes. take it. And like, we're coming for seconds and thirds. Like,
yes. Hayden, what do you think?
Yeah, I kind of just want, like one of the questions that I would get when I started doing all of this was like, oh, when was the first time you felt like represented in a book? And, you know, back in the day, I had to like pull something that hit like one of my identities. So if it was like Simon versus the Homo Sapiens Agenda, or if it was like Ari and Dante, but it was really a lie. And eventually I just was like, well, I have it. And that's why right. I wrote Cemetery Boys, because like, according to media, you know, books, TV shows, movies, like people like me don't exist. So that's really freeing. And I just want more of every kind of like Latinidad queer book, like in every kind of genre. I want us to have like a plethora, not just like four to choose from. Yes. And especially like when it comes to writing trans stories, like yes, there's not enough queer stories, but there's also not enough trans stories like at all. For the sure. fact that I'm the first out trans author to hit list with a fiction like trans main character for the first time, that should have never happened. Mm-hmm. And so while I hold that title very humbly and dearly, it also frustrates me a lot, especially when it comes to BIPOC rep and trans rep. Felix Ever After should have been the first book to hit list, but whatever. Right. I can talk about that for hours. So yeah, I just want more of everything. I want the market to be like flooded with stories so that, you know, the up and coming generations don't have to like deal with what I did, where it's like I never saw a book with me, so I had to write it when I was like, you know, an adult. Like, so instead of yes. writing the book that I wish I had when I was younger, I want those books to already be there for young readers.
Exactly. Hard agree. Yes. No, I agree with what both of you are saying, especially because there's like, especially when it comes to like the coming out narrative, there are like so many other layers to it when you're also totally. Latinx. So like, I won't get into it. It's rough out there. It's hard. It's confusing. Language is confusing. Access is confusing. Knowledge is confusing. So yeah. Yes, I appreciate both of you sort of unpacking that in your stories. And kind of related to that is what I want to talk about next, which is machismo. Yes. So it's one of my favorite things to talk about just because it's so messy. But both of you explore, unpack, and challenge machismo in your stories in very different ways. So first, I want to know, how do you define machismo for yourself? Because I know it's kind of hard to pinpoint as a definition. How do you experience it, if you want to share that? And how were you trying to address that in your story? I'm going to switch it up and let Aiden go first.
Yeah, I mean, machismo for me is just like the quintessential toxic masculinity, right? Mm-hmm. And I think the important part is that it affects more than just like the machismos who are acting against people, but also like, you know, growing up as like if you're a masculine presenting person, like you also have all these ideals forced upon you. So it's really an ever present and kind of spreading almost like a disease, honestly.
Yep.
And so how do you fight against that? And it's funny. I don't read Goodreads, but I have friends who will read Goodreads and like fill me in on it. And there's been a couple of reviews from white folks who are like, I didn't like this book or I DNF'd it because it was sexist. And I was like, I think you're missing the point. The point being that Latinx culture, especially like religion and just kind of practices, can be very focused and gendered, being like the women do this, the men do this, which is why I set up the magic system in Cemetery Boys the way it is. But what's important is instead of being like, all of this is wrong, like Latinx people are awful because they're sexist, it's like, okay, no, let's unpack it and actually like make changes that are sustaining instead of just denying an entire culture and kind of belief system, which is problematic for a number of different reasons. Yeah, so it's like how, and that's kind of what's going on within the Brujex community in Cemetery Boys. It's unpacking that machismo, that toxic masculinity, and how do we move forward from it? And how do these changes not limit or guard our history, but how does it enable us to grow and become a stronger community? So for me, that's what I was trying to do with Cemetery Boys, was show that.
Oof. Yes, hard agree, and yes, big topic to tackle, but I think you did it.
And it's not something that's just fixed overnight, you know, it's a systemic problem.
Exactly.
That takes, you know, time.
That's what I also find really interesting about some reviews. It's like, well, the characters didn't like come to a super healthy place by the end or like fix everything by the end.
It's like, yeah.
We can't, as individuals, fix systemic issues.
Yeah.
That's a whole other tangent. But Johnny, what about you?
No, like, I'm going to go off that point real quick. Like, I was in an interview a couple days ago. I don't remember. But we were like, talking about, like, just Joel's and his coming out process. And, like, I was talking about how, like, the thing that I really don't like about a lot of, like, It Gets Better narratives is that they don't really focus on the fact that, like, nothing about the environment in which you are already living changes the next day. Like, even if you were in a harmful environment the day before you came out, it might not be an embracing environment the next day. Like, things don't just get fixed. And I really wanted to focus on the fact that, like, some people in your life are just going to choose to be ignorant and be assholes. And, like, you just got to figure out what to do with that. Like, not everyone is going to embrace you. And you just got to learn, you got to adapt. Like, just, you know, that's just how it is.
It's true.
But, like, yeah. And so I actually had to think about this machismo question for a while. But, like, I think, like, ultimately, I feel like machismo is just fear. Like, it's fear of the loss of power that happens when we see gender as this rigid binary that has, like, specific cans and cannots attached to them. And it's a fear that, like, will not only want equality, but equity and visibility. And, like, one that really relies on a lack of thought and empathy. And for my book, I really just wanted to create something of a contrast between that and, like, the opposite of what that looks like. Like, we have Jules's dad who like, at least one other character who kind of have these just pretty immovable and dated opinions on what men shouldn't say and do and act like and be attracted to or want to be. But we also have, like, people like Rolly, who has his own experience with, like, coming to terms with machismo. And we have people like Jordan and Binya, who are both just so comfortable showing physical affection to their friend and being emotional and supporting happiness over societal standards. So I wanted to show, like, it exists, but it also, like, what does the opposite of that look like? And, like, what does, like, embrace, like, not even being tolerant, like, what does embracing someone look like?
Yes. I'm so glad you said that, because I feel like a lot of cis people or cishet people specifically don't understand that there's a difference between, like, celebrating someone and embracing them as opposed to just tolerating them and being like, okay, I know that you're this and, like, I'm okay with that. That's not actually, like, being an ally or even, like, celebrating, like, you know, the queer people in your life. So yeah, there is a distinction there. And I definitely agree. I think machismo is about fear of losing power. And it's definitely strongly internalized, not only something that happens externally, but it's internal as well. And wow, okay, that's my garage, so ignore that. But God, I lost my train of thought. Yeah, machismo, it is internal, it is external. It is about loss of power. Completely lost my thought. Completely lost my thought. I was gonna get to it, but not. No, but I completely agree. And especially with what you said about your environment not changing overnight. Nope, lost it again. So that's what the garage does to you. So this is, that's who I am. If it comes back, it comes back. But I completely agree with both of you were saying, and I appreciate how your stories do address machismo, which is extremely rampant in Latinx communities, especially because people use it as, like, a crutch, that thing that, like, it's ingrained, like, it's part of our culture. And also sometimes culture is tied to religion as well. So it's like, it's part of our religion, it's part of our belief system. It's the way it's always been done. So it's a big excuse that people fall back on in our community. So I appreciate how both of your stories address machismo. I think I just got back around to my point. So I'm proud of myself. but I also want to know, I'm curious to know, what books or titles do your books get comped with in the industry? And what titles do you want it to be in conversation with? So Johnny, what about you? What do you think?
My usual comps are like Simon versus the Homo Sapiens Agenda and Aristotle and Dante. The first one, like, I've actually been using since I was queering, so I really don't mind it. Like, but I also recognize like that it's not, it's just the closest that I have. It's not necessarily like, oh, this is perfect. It's just what's within arm's reach. And like the other one I feel is often kind of just solely used because Mexican. And like, even though, again, it's literally historical fiction, as beautiful as another science's prose is, like, it's historical fiction. I think the ones that I liked to be compared to you are often like Juliet Takes a Breath. Like, I
love that. Yes.
I feel like it kind of has this same like vibe of like, I don't know, maybe like I'm complimenting myself, but like it's almost more like storytelling than like book writing, I feel, is the way that story. And like, cause I knew when writing my book that it was not like built like other books. Like, it's kind of
not built like other books.
It's built different. And so like, that had been mentioned a lot of times. And so I read that book and I was like, oh shit, like I can, like, it's fine. Like, books exist that don't necessarily correlate to the natural, like, here's the plot and like, here's where the big thing happens and like end. So I love to get compared to that book. And then even like, this is kind of an epic love story by Kacen Callender. I like read that book right after drafting this one. And I was like, oh my God, like they're like literally cousins, these two. And so I really love being compared to that one and just like any gay soccer book.
I was gonna say, I have the Passing Playbook here. I think I would just
compare. Oh heck yeah.
About people in soccer.
So good.
I'm just gonna, whenever I get my hardcovers, I want to take a picture of like all the gay soccer books with my gay soccer.
Yes. Books. What other gay soccer books are there now?
I mean, there's the Passing Playbook, Simon Versus.
Julie Richards, Lions.
Running with Lions.
I think the rom-com I'm writing is also based on soccer.
Don't tease us.
Just like add like a little drawing of a spine for Aiden's and for Rocky. and for Rocky.
Yes, and for Rockies.
Yeah.
So Aiden, what about you? What titles is your book compared to, and which ones do you want it to be compared to?
Or so when I had to do. Yeah, when I had to do like the official, like what are the comps, I used Coco, which is what most people use when comparing to Cemetery Boys, which they're very different, but kind of being centered around Dia de Muertos. And I actually have a very soft spot for Coco, being someone who celebrates Dia de Muertos. It's my favorite holiday. I think I've said that about 8 times at this point. Also, not just that, but I'm from California. I go to Disneyland a lot, or used to go to Disneyland all the time. And I keep on talking about things I get emotional over when I'm really not a crier. So it's very interesting that we're having this whole conversation.
Bring it in.
There is a certain sort of magic that I experience, that I witness when I go to Disneyland and I see that they have Princess Elena of Avalor. And how she talks to it's Disneyland is in LA. It's a huge Latinx community, and seeing her speaking in Spanish to young kids makes me want to bawl my eyes out. And while I was drafting, I think it was either right before I started drafting Cemetery Boys, or it was like right after, I went to Disneyland with my friends, and it was in September, and they had a whole area in California Adventure that was dedicated to Dia de Muertos, and it was beautiful. And seeing it was, I can't. They had these whole bunch of different like arts and crafts set up, having to do with the holiday and like information about the holiday. They had ofrendas set up and stuff like that. And I know that Disney is evil, but bringing Like, I get it. Like, I get it.
I love it. I get hot it. Takes.
But the way that they brought, yeah, the way that they were able to bring Latino community, Latinx culture, specifically Dia de Muertos, into the limelight, and to actually, to not only kind of introduce it to people who aren't familiar with it, but to also make those like little, like brown kids running around the park, like feel seen and be like, oh yeah, I know all about this, is very special and dear thing. Okay, so that's Coco. Okay, I like Coco.
I love Coco. And then
the other like official book that I comped it to was actually The Outsiders. Mm-hmm. Half of that was because S.E. Hinton is a raging transphobe. And so I was like, ha. But another part of it was that Julian and his found family, it was definitely kind of shaped after The Outsiders. And there's like a very direct Easter egg with the kind of cake that Rio makes. Mm. So those are like the official ones. In terms of ones that I wanted to be in conversation with, it would be like, gosh, books. Labyrinth Lost, I feel like more people need to talk about that. So I also talk about it all the time. Zoraida definitely thinks I'm stalking her at this point, and I'm so sorry. I like bring it up in every interview I do. So I think that one would be really cool. And a big book that I read before I started drafting Cemetery Boys that kind of helped build, like, help me figure out, like, what ghosts and spirits are and how they move within this world was Anna Dressed in Blood by Kendar Blake. Mm-hmm. Which is like one of my, it's really good. So I would like it to be in conversation with that more.
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's it.
I would also in the future like to see it in, I would like to see it in conversation with The Witch King by H.E. Edgeman, which is another trans fantasy book. I'm just plugging everything at this point. We have another attack for Aiden. This is a question for Aiden. No. I know you've thought a lot about writing gay cowboys. Have you ever gone to Bota Loca in Oakland or Tempo in LA?
Bota Loca, I haven't been there, but I know of it. Oh my gosh, what a deep dive. Yeah, like I am not like a club person, so I haven't actually like been inside. Like I'm way too awkward and, you know, queer for that. I'm just like afraid of everything.
Move.
So I haven't been there, but yeah, Bota Loca. Yeah, I haven't been to that club, but I know of it.
Aiden's like, future research trip.
Yeah, I'll just awkwardly stand in the corner.
Yeah, just taking notes, like, oh, this is what people do in clubs. So I have another question for Aiden, since you're the more experienced author, the big wig, 2 times New York Times bestselling author, no big deal. But as a bestselling published author, what is something that you didn't expect? And what advice would you pass on to Johnny as they get closer to publication? What I hope is world domination, personally.
I didn't expect any part of it, honestly. It's so funny because no one thought Cemetery Boys was going to be anything, like including myself. Moonreads, which is a now defunct imprint, was like an imprint of an imprint. It was Macmillan, by Will and Friends, and by Will and Friends was operated Moonreads. You know, it's the tiniest little advances. It's like really not great contracts, and you know, tiny, maybe non-existent budgets for marketing and stuff like that. So no one saw it coming. I thought maybe 50 people would buy it. when I started like talking about the book and getting excited, and I was like, I'm going to do a pre-order campaign because those are really fun. Mm. I thought maybe 25 people would enter it. So I like was just doing all of this promo and marketing on my own, right? Just being like, la-di-da-di-da, I'm going to go to the world. And then suddenly it started like escalating and getting more attention and more people were talking about it. And yeah, it was really like me and my team were suddenly like, oh, okay, this might be something. And so kind of scrambling to kind of fit that need. And then to go from only expecting 25 people to be submitting to my pre-order campaign to over 2,800 people. And then me being like, oh my God. So Macmillan was very kind and fulfilled the domestic stuff, but I still did all the international. and it cost over $1,300. I actually had to borrow money from friends in order to pay for it, which is why it took so long for people to get their stuff, because it's like, I literally don't have money to buy postage, but as soon as I do, I was like sending off batches like every time I got paid from my full-time job. So the whole experience has been really unexpected, but I think the most wonderful part about it is the reader response. And I think the biggest bummer is doing this during a pandemic and not being able to meet and see readers in person. And kind of how do you manage expectations when that happens? It's very strange that I have two New York Times bestselling books, but I've never been able to hang out with readers or like see people who like it. So it's almost like everything, my success exists on my laptop and it's fake, you know, like no one actually knows. Like it's just like, everything's hypothetical at this point. Like I don't have like any lines to be like signing books or stuff like that. A couple of weeks ago, I went to a local Barnes and Noble, and I'm always scared going in. I check and make sure that they even have my books like to begin with, because I don't want to embarrass myself. They're like, oh, we don't stock that, and they're like, oh, okay, I'm gonna leave now. So I make sure that the book is there, and then I go up to someone like very meekly. I'm like, hi, oh, I'm Hayden. I was just wondering if I could like sign your stock. And I did that. And there was three workers there who got very excited and like brought all the books over, and then they bought extra copies so I could like personalize them. And so I think that that's something that's going to be like really fun and exciting, is kind of to, my rule of thumb is to always keep your expectations super low so that when anything exciting happens, it's literally the best thing that's ever happened to me in that moment. I think that's kind of, yeah, because we're still in a pandemic. So yeah, to kind of manage your expectations and to really enjoy and be so happy and really appreciate and kind of sit with moments as they come up is like really important. And it's a wonderful feeling. So it's going to be very exciting. I can't wait for June.
That is precious that you thought 25 people were going to be interested in the Cemetery Boys Cafe.
That was a lot, too. Like,
we had more people than that in our like quarantine pages interview who were all like, I'm pre-ordering this book right now.
Yeah. It was like the smallest amount of like character cards I could buy was 100 at a time. So I was like, oh, man, I'm going to have these for forever. Yeah.
Psych. But I think you touched on a really interesting point, because like you said, we've been in a pandemic. So like your whole like author existence has really been online, which is kind of related to what we're talking about here with 1500 Miles from the Sun, which is this relationship that takes place mostly online. So what's that been like for you, Johnny? Because as well, like you're kind of planning your debut around just mostly being strictly online. So what's that experience been like for you?
Yeah, like, I mean, the whole process has been in a pandemic. Like when I signed my contract, we were already, and I think the last time I went to Starbucks and like sat outside of Starbucks, I had gotten a call from my agent, like, hey, someone's interested. And like, that was the last time I've ever been in a pandemic. I mean, in a pandemic.
That was the last time we ever heard about that.
This is the last pandemic. But yeah, like I think that it's really weird just to like not necessarily have that sort of like normal experience of being an author, but it's also, I think, a lot more intimate in a lot of ways, because like now I really have no experience in it, but like I feel like I've made just a lot of friends like on social media, like, and just kind of garnered excitement on social media and like use that kind of as like a primary tool of like, hey, I got a book out, and like also just having people like at me and be like, hey, I'm reading your book. And it's like, oh my God, this is so special. I couldn't even imagine what that would feel like to have that in person. Like someone in front of me tell me, hey, I read your book. Like, no, I would walk away. I would walk away, like find the nearest exit and just like,
okay, great.
Yeah. I don't know if I could handle that. But like, yeah, it's been nothing like I expected. And when we're figuring it out. And also really exciting, and like hopefully I'll get to like talk about really exciting things that are happening, like with my launch and stuff.
Teasers. Yeah, that must be a weird feeling, like navigating people being like adding you, like, hey, like, I'm reading your book right now. I love it. Which is like bizarre because like I don't want to date myself, but like when I was younger, like there was no way to like get in contact with authors. There'd be like at the back of the book, it'd be like, if you're interested in talking or sending a letter to so and so, send it to this P.O. box in New York and like some assistant will get to it or whatever. So the fact that you can just like at authors on Twitter is bizarre to me. Like I don't know what any of us are doing, honestly. So that's just my thought process. What are some things you're anticipating, Johnny, as you get closer? Because we're almost like less than a month away from June 8th.
For like my sanity to just go to a minimal. to just be like a former shell of what I was by the 9th, probably. to like just kind of escape into a cave in July, hopefully. I don't know.
You should.
I want that for you. I want that for you.
You should. That's what I did. That
for me. Like,
take a break.
Start planning it now.
Yeah. Like, especially as someone who like has a lot of just social anxiety, like by that point, I'm just going to be like, no, like, it's going to be like whenever I get drunk and at the clubs and like I start getting really friendly when I'm drunk, but then I'm at a point where I remember that I'm like completely an introvert and I just run out of the club like without telling my friends. And so that's probably what I'm going to do. I'm just going to not tell anyone and just leave sometime in July.
Please do it.
Yeah, and I forgot the question already, but yeah.
What you were expecting, but that's fine. You're expecting to run away.
I'm expecting to run away and just like have fun, hopefully. Like, hopefully have some fun. Like, yeah.
Definitely have fun.
You're like,
enjoy it while it's happening.
You know, if we can get this thing planned, like, it'll be fun, I think.
Yeah. You better have a plan by this point. You're like less than a month away. You know, don't give me secondhand anxiety for you.
I would think, but.
But. But I know you, Johnny. I know you don't have it under control.
It's fine.
Also, I thought of this question this morning, so I apologize for not sending it to you beforehand. But I was thinking just like on a fun note, since, you know, the whole story is kind of predicated on Matt sliding into Jules' DMs, I want to know what's one of the most bizarre or interesting interactions you've had online. You don't have to name names, whatever's in your comfort zone, but what's it like out there? Johnny, what's it like out there?
I don't really like have any I don't know. You know, I feel like it really happened was like whenever like I was in college and I got some interesting Facebook messages from my fraternity brothers from like from weird places that were interesting to read. But yeah, that's probably
Facebook is another level.
Yeah, because like I mean like at this time last year, or even like in 2019, I only had like a couple hundred followers on Twitter. So like, I really haven't known like a lot of people to be coming into my DMs. I don't know. Like, yeah.
Who knows what the future holds?
Who knows? I'm excited for whatever. No, I'm not. I'm not excited for whatever.
No, you're not excited for that.
I'm excited to meet some of those messages one day.
Please. But what about you, Aiden? Whatever you're comfortable with.
I would like to say a weird thing that I did. Sure. When I was trying to figure out like launching and like getting blurbs and stuff like that, like my publisher was like, oh, here's people you have connections to. But like my like dream person was Adam Silvera. Mm-hmm. And I was very scared to like ask him. I was like, he's not going to know who I am. I was like, he's busy. He's like very important. He's not going to like, who am I? So I was not sober, to preface this. And I typed up like a message to him in my notes. I copied it and I like drafted it on Twitter. And I was like, I sat there for like half an hour, just like sweating profusely, being like, oh, should I do it? Should I not do it? I got a little even like less more sober. And then I like hit send, and it was like 11:30 at night. It was really late. It was just me like, hey, like, this is me. Like, you follow me, you've expressed interest in cemetery boys, blah, 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 would you mind maybe? And I thought for sure that I would just like never hear from him or that he would like block me. But then he messaged back and was like, oh my gosh, yes, I'd absolutely love to. So shooting your shot is really important and just kind of going for it. Yeah.
No, I feel like literally whenever like I had mentioned like the people that like I wanted to blurb, and there was like a list of people who I was like, yeah, on Twitter, like these authors have like said something at some point or like liked a tweet about my book at some point, and like I think they are at least minimally interested. Maybe we can ask them. And my editor was like, okay, Johnny, so then you got it, right? Like you can go ask them. And I was like, that's not what I said. I said they can.
No.
I didn't say I would ask them. But they were like, okay, so you're gonna handle that. And like literally absolutely same thing. Like I definitely drank a little bit and like was on my notes app, like trying to figure out the wording that I was going like word endings, like, oh my god, like hi. I know we're not friends.
Oh my god,
but like, you know, if you have time, like if you might want to do this, like not right now, you don't have to do it right now, like for sure not right now, but like later, if like you don't have anything later, like if you are free, like on Thursday the 20th at 8 p.m., on Thursday the 25th at 8 p.m., like I will have something for you, like if you want. And it ended up like not like it was so nice, like everyone's so fucking nice. And so like it's just it that anxiety of
that
just
anxiety,
like going up to someone even virtually who like you've never really talked to before, but they've been like, oh my god, I can't wait for your like your book once.
Yeah.
But apparently like you know them well enough for your editor to say go get them, like,
yeah.
It's a struggle. I was so scared. I was like texting 4 different people, like, do I have to do this? Like, how do I do this? Does this sound right? Like, it was
no idea. I'm so glad that other people like draft things like in their notes app before like running right somewhere else. Because I'm like, what is this? I sound
very
like an
stressful
idiot.
And it
worked. None of us know what we're doing.
I got all these lovely words. So like it worked.
By just sheer will.
Yeah.
Well, those were all the questions I had. So if anyone has any last minute questions in the live chat you want to drop, that's fine. We're going to start wrapping up here. I figure before we do like the whole like plug your book type thing, I might ask like if you have anything, what you've been reading recently or like books you think people should look forward to besides 1500 Miles from the Sun.
That's obviously literally my answer to like
pre-order links in the description. What have you been reading lately, Johnny?
I just finished Blazerath Games. So now I get to go
read. Right.
So now I get to go read 2 Blaze 2 Wrath right after this.
I literally can't remember the name of Amparo's sequel. I literally, my brain call it 2 Blaze 2 Wrath like, all the time.
That.
You know, I call it something like that, like most Blaze, very Wrath. Like, whatever like comes to mind is like what it's called. It's Dragon Blood Ring.
Dragon Blood Ring.
I think. Amparo will correct
that
this.
That seems so right. Amparo, you can tell us if
yeah
wrong.
So I get to read that in like the next week or so, and I'm looking forward to that. Some of my favorites this year have been like Somewhere Between Bitter and Sweet by Lake and Zaya Kemp, That Chance Charlie Vega by Crystal Maldonado, Me Cute Diary by Emery Lee. I think I read This Is How We Fly this year, and that one was really good too.
It is.
Yeah. Oh, and I finally got to reading You Just Need a Crown and like obsessed.
Yes.
So,
yeah, it's great.
Ambata says, yes, it is Dragon Blood Ring. Thank you.
I'm reading The Ones We're Meant to Find and Gideon the Ninth, which I know everybody knows about, but I like just
my reaction was for The Ones We're Meant to Find.
Yes, which I'm so it's like right up my alley. I'm very excited.
It's so good. I can't wait for you to get to the end because I was like yelling for the last
I'm
100 pages. It is crazy. I mean, I just want to like shout out some trans fiction, obviously. So I talked about The Passing Playbook by Isaac Fitzsimons, which is coming out maybe the same date as yours, Johnny. So that's soon. Or June 1st.
Yeah, that one's the first.
Yeah.
And then also The Ghosts We Keep by Mason Deaver, which is perfection. That's also coming out in June. And then this one's also coming out in June, The Witch King by A.G. Edgeworth.
They literally
I think all of these come out on the same day, so I'm sorry.
Like, I already have like a list of my pile that I should expect on June 1st, and it is expensive.
I also recently finished May the Best Man Win by Z.R. Eller, which comes out, I think, May 18th. So next week, I think, by the time you're watching this. So that one was really good. It was wild. So that's what I've been reading. So now...
I read You Reach Sam recently, and that one,
oh,
like...
Yes.
I have that arc.
I haven't read a book that just, like, destroyed my soul in so long, and so I really enjoyed that. Like, it just wrecked me.
I want to read that book so badly. Good to know that I will be destroyed. But, so now we're going to wrap up, so I kind of want to know what can we look forward to from both of you, what's next, if there's anything you can tease us with, and then I'll obviously... tell people to pre-order 1500 Miles from the Sun, and you can talk about your pre-order campaign and all that stuff. So I'll let you go first, Johnny.
Okay. So yeah, 1500 Miles from the Sun, out June 8th. There's a pre-order campaign that you can go and do on my Twitter. Like there's my what's it called? My pinned like all the info for a couple of character cards and a signed book place you can get. And then if you request it at your local library, you can also get a special character art card for that as well.
Big deal.
What was the rest of the question? Like, what?
That's pretty much it. Tell people to pre-order 1500 Miles from the Sun.
Oh, okay, yeah. 1500 Miles from the Sun. And also, and you can go and add my new book, Honor Something Right Here, on Goodreads if you want.
Yes. About you, Aiden.
So my next stuff coming down the pipeline is I have a duology that's coming out. The first one's going to be out in fall 2022, so soon. And it is like The Hunger Games meets Percy Jackson, where there's demigods in a battle for life and death. And then in 2024, I have my first sci-fi coming out, which is, the working title is Gay Titanic in Space. And you can add them on Goodreads. They're already up there.
I cannot wait for that one. And if you don't slide into my DMs on that one, I will be offended, just for the record. But yeah, I don't see any other questions from anyone. So we will wrap up there. Thank you both for taking the time to hang out and chat. This was really wonderful. And thank you everyone watching for coming to hang out with us on this fine Saturday. I hope you've all enjoyed yourselves and that you have a great rest of your day. So pre-order 1500 Miles from the Sun, link in the description below, as well to the pre-order campaign. So yeah. Have a good day, everyone. Bye.
Bye. Thank you so much.